All right, so Sonia, please come up. She wants to share. This church has a tremendous heart for missions, and we are grateful for that. And we are so thankful that this is another opportunity, something that Sonia's heart is close to, and she's already involved with. There you go. You're up.
First, I have a video I'd like for you to watch.
It was lunchtime, and my father was praying for the lunch that we were about to eat. But there was only one problem. Our table was empty. My earliest recollections is finding myself at the age of 5, roaming the streets, eating from dumpsters. We were not able to have food at all, at all.
We were forced to live with 17 for other relatives in a very small shanty.
No toilets.
A lot of crime.
No running water.
There's a lot of rape for children.
If you want to be out of poverty, then you have to deal with drugs.
Some of my friends were actually sold into prostitution.
And as darkness and ghastliness, the devil takes over.
One morning, I just woke up that, you know, my uncle is just touching me in some parts of my body that I just thought to myself that this can't be happening.
My father was murdered right next to my mother. And I knew that moment that my life had changed.
I watched as my 10-month-old sister died in the laps of my mother out of starvation.
My relatives always tell me, Michelle, you are so ugly. You look exactly like your father. You will become nothing but a thief and a drug addict when you grow up. And those were the words that I heard from people whom I expected to love and take care of me.
Poverty had told me I am hopeless, I am nothing, and I believed that. But right in the middle of this desperation, it was then that compassion intervened.
One Sunday morning, my Aunt Carol, she registered me in that compassion project.
What joy and dancing came to my home at the news that I finally got a sponsor.
And it's still my first letter.
We wrote back and forth.
He told me, you're my first friend outside my continent.
She said words like, Richmond, I love you.
And that lightened me up.
My sponsor told me that, Michelle, you are beautiful. You are precious to us. We are proud of you, and we are praying for you, and we love you. And the words touched the very depth of my heart and soul.
Eighteen years later, here I am, a child, rescued from hopelessness. She was 15 years old. Her name is Ashley.
Her name was Heather. I called her mom.
One act saved my life. When you act, the choice is yours.
Sponsor a child through compassion today.
Release a child from poverty.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
So as a widow, I can tell you that I have a lot of comfort in the Word of God when He speaks to widows and orphans. And as you can imagine, when I would read through these scriptures and I would see orphans, and I would think to myself, how am I impacting the life of an orphan? And what does this refer to? And so there began my journey only a couple of months ago where this was, God was really laying this on my heart. So around the same time, I was reading an article on Haiti. It is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, and so poor that 80% of the, as far as our country, the poorest person in our country doesn't even come close to the poor that you see in these other countries. 80% of the poor, the poorest in this country, is wealthier than these children. A lot of violence is going on in Haiti, and a lot of violence has gone on for years. At the end of the article, there was a statement of Compassion International and how they were impacting these children's lives and had for many, many years. And so I clicked on, and I wanted to learn more. And I want to jump forward a little bit because confirmation to this journey of orphans and children in need, the further confirmation came as I made a journey a few weeks ago and met a missionary couple who, after the Hurricane Matthew, as you may recall, just devastated Haiti. And they heard stories of children who had disabilities where their parents were basically going and putting them in the dump. They were just sending them there to die. And that was really what was happening. And they said, you know, we can't just sit here and watch this go on. And they went down there with no medical training, just their heart, the love of Jesus. And they took these families and they helped them to plant food. And they helped the children in any way that they could get the medical care they needed. Sometimes it was just holding them and nourishing them with their love while they died in their arms. And I watched a man as big as a tree stand up and give his testimony with tears just pouring from his eyes on these children that he had seen. And so I came to him very anxiously with a picture of a girl that I just recently sponsored in Haiti. And so there are no accidents, right? And he said, yes, Compassion International, they're one of the good ones. So I come to that and say there's a lot of organizations out there that want to help others. And we know that. But we know that without the power of Jesus, the help can do nothing. Because without salvation, what do they really have? So this organization stands in the name of Jesus to help these children. And that's the difference. I also want you to know, for instance, let's take a country like Haiti. Violence is rampant. Compassion International, when their workers are there, they don't have to leave the country when the violence is in there. A lot of organizations have to leave. They have been in the country for 50 years, and they're a national organization there in that country, so they don't have to leave. I'm very happy to share with you today a picture. We don't have it up on the big screen, but I want you to at some point after the service, if you would come up and look into her eyes. Her name is Rose Darlene.
Can we pass it around, please?
Yes. And she is 6 years old, soon to turn 7 years old next week. I was hoping to receive a letter, and I was praying that I would receive word from her that she was okay, mostly because of the violence that was going on. And 3 days ago, I got a letter from her. And a translator, of course, is translating for her. She drew a picture of herself with flowers and a dog. And I know that she loves the color red and that she loves dogs. And she has a doll. Her grandmother takes care of her. She is a true orphan. She has a brother and a sister. And she has an aunt that I know of. She wants to be a doctor when she grows up. She's going to a Christian school. She's going to a Baptist church. The love of Jesus is already there. The presence of him is around this community. And I would just ask you, as my church family, in sponsoring this child, today is what we call Compassion Sunday. All over the country, we are asking for those, if it's in their heart, to sponsor a child, to do so. But my prayer is that your prayers would be for this one child in our congregation. It doesn't have to be the money that you spend. It's your heart for her salvation, right? For any of us. So if you would pray for Rose Darlene as we go forward, and I will keep you informed on her progress. I would just like to also just leave with you the one thing before I go, and that is God's word on the fatherless. And God, who numbers the hairs on our head, is also the father to the fatherless. He knows each waiting child by name and affirms their value with great love and compassion through scripture. Isaiah 1:17, learn to do right, seek justice, encourage the oppressed, defend the cause of the fatherless, plead the cause of the widow. And we know James, religion that is pure and undefiled before God, the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. Psalm 82:3, defend the cause of the weak and the fatherless, maintain the rights of the poor and the oppressed. Deuteronomy, he defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the alien, giving him food and clothing. And most importantly, I just want to leave you with this, as we know that our Lord Jesus spoke of orphans. There are over 30 references in Scripture to orphans. Orphans are important to the Lord God, and they're important. And Jesus, in making a reference to them, told us a very beautiful promise that I hope and is my prayer for Rose Darlene, that this becomes her life statement, where Jesus said and told us as his children, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. I have packets in the back for anyone who is ready to sponsor a child. If you want more information, I also have brochures, and I'll be there to answer any questions you might have. Thank you so much.
Praise God. Savior, his name is Jesus. Let's lift him up this morning. Anybody needs some extra food? See peppers, see salad.
Potatoes, that we have at the rec center, so if anybody wants some, let me know.
Here we go.
Our offering, Father, not only in monetary, but also in our time for you.
out of your seat and you need to pray at the altar with us, let's go to Jesus now. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name. We enter your gates with thanksgiving, into your courts with praise. Father, we thank you for this day you've given us. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you. We thank you, Jesus, for Compassion International, for all agencies, all ministries to reach out, Lord, to the orphans, the widows, Lord, to just people living in horrific situations. Jesus, we are so blessed. They forgive us. There are surely times we've taken our blessings for granted. Things that concern us sometimes shouldn't. And Lord, there are people we know in other parts of this world. They're starving. Trying to survive. And Lord, keep that before us. Keep us keep a burden on us, Lord, a healthy burden of love for those that are the least of these parts of this world. And Lord, that could be us in this country. Things could go bad quickly. I just pray and give thanks today and praise you that the body of Christ, through people at this church, Jesus, it's so good to be the pastor here, the people at this church reach out in our own community and across the water, across the world the best we can, and you multiply that. I thank you for all of the body of Christ that reaches out to those in need. Jesus, today we lift up the sick, and I want to give praise today. Can you tell everybody the name of the young lady whose cancer was removed? We give you praise, Jesus. Jesus, we have prayed for, it's Kelly, right, Kenny? We have prayed for Kelly, and Lord, we know others have prayed, and she has been cleared of the cancer. There's no sign of cancer. That can only be your hand, Jesus. We give you praise today for that. Church, give him praise. Here, let me help you. Jesus, we love you. And we praise you. Hallelujah. Father, we pray today for all the sick, putting our trust in you for every ailment, every illness, every emotional struggle, everyone that's struggling with depression, please help them, Lord. Everyone that has a decision to make, Lord, whatever that may be, give them peace and direction and guide them. Jesus, we pray this morning for the prodigal sons and daughters that they would come home. Say the names, church. We just pray for them. Whisper the names if you don't want to say them out loud. Pray. Pray that they come home to Jesus. And we praise you and thank you for those that you're going to save. We pray for the lost. Jesus, that you will reach out to the lost. If they won't hear us, that you'll send somebody that will hear. We, like you, Jesus, want people to go to heaven. You are the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other way to the Father but through you. Help us, Lord, become fishers of men. Gospel everywhere we go. Be careful to praise you. Lord, as we get ready to worship you in song, as we get ready to get into your word, we're just praying that your Holy Spirit would take completely over this service as you have, and just please receive the glory. Let there be joy in your house. Please keep the enemy far away. It is in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children said. Amen.
should be seeing these days.
And we want.
Before I start, this is a hard time of the year for me. This is the year when I lost. This is the time of the year that I'm reminded of my parents and my in-laws, both gone now to be with God. But they seem closest to me. My mom's birthday was Friday. My mother-in-law's is today. Both my father-in-law and my father died right at this time of the year. And my mother-in-law, come to think of it. So it's important that we listen to the words to this song, even though I might flub up a couple of times. Listen to what it says, because we sometimes ask this question, and we have to answer it. What if God says no? Okay, Joseph.
Enough we have His grace.
please stand.
Holy.
situations in life. We'll praise Him. He gives and takes away. So, that's one of my surf rods. Isn't that a beautiful surf ride? The scenery is not too bad either, right? I said, Minnie, here come the pelicans. I said, seagulls, I got it wrong. Here come the pelicans. And they were just, you know, they're such big, awkward birds. They look so graceful coming over the water. I said, get ready. And here they come. So you got that awesome picture. Isn't that good?
Amen.
Is it okay to go fishing? Huh? Is it even better to go fishing for souls? Yeah?
Yes.
I like fishing. If you like fishing, say amen.
Amen.
All right. If you like fishing too much, say amen, Gary.
Amen.
Hollis. Jack. Hollis, we got some ate-up fishermen here. Good fishermen, I might add.
And women.
So, I haven't always been good at... I like to fish, but I haven't always been good at the catching part. Right? I'm really good at fishing, but the catching part, not always so good. I am pretty good at catching a tan. Especially here in Florida. Some very good fishermen in the room, as we've already mentioned, and good fisherwomen, I might add. I'm on a long, I'm not going to tell you how long, I'm on a long slump of catching pompano. I love to eat pompano, love to catch pompano, and people catch them all around me. I mean, 100 yards this way, I feel like. Have you ever went fishing and said, oh, Jesus, please? Have you negotiated with Jesus at the fishing hut? I mean, come on. So there's a good fisherwoman in here. I'm on this lengthy slump with catching pompano. I mean, I studied it. I do all the things right. And we're there, and lo and behold, who catches, what was it, 18 inches? 17 inch pompano, Mindy. Keeping me humble. I did catch the fish you can't eat that day. That was a little shark. And, well, that was all I caught, actually. Didn't even caught the stingray. All right. Fishing. We're talking about fishing. We're also wondering what in the world happened to Peter. Last time we were together, sort of, we were talking about that Jesus had risen. He's risen from the dead. Amen?
Amen.
Peter, though, what happened to Peter? We had preached about Peter. We talked about Peter. We're going to kind of look at that today. Peter, eyes of a fisherman, looking through the eyes of the fisherman. And we'll see that going forward for the next several weeks. Jesus had risen. The 11, why did I say 11? Because there wasn't 12 at that point. The 11 should have been happy because their Savior was risen, though they didn't understand up until that point, and were just starting to understand. He had made himself known to them. He had showed himself to them. But was Peter happy? Peter had left his former occupation. I'm sensing that Peter was a good fisherman. He made a living at it. I wonder sometimes, Hollis and Gary and Jack and Perry, I wonder if my life depended on it, my family's existence depended on me catching fish, if we would survive more than a day.
Long name.
We'd be eating shark. For 3+ years, Peter followed Jesus. Peter was bold during that time, remember? He had even got out of the boat and walked on water, though for a short moment, when he took his eyes off of Jesus, he had the courage. We like to get after Peter for his mistakes, and we got a lot of mistakes too, don't we? But he had some guts, then he had some boldness to get out of that boat and walk, and he followed Jesus for 3+ years. Peter was convinced, we saw that in past weeks, he was convinced of his commitment to Jesus Christ.
I'm curious how this will go. Are you convinced with your commitment to Jesus Christ?
Amen. Praise God.
Am I convinced with my commitment? But when the test came, there's always tests, isn't there? There's always some sort of life test we're going through. I thought when I graduated from high school, barely, that the tests were over with.
Yes.
Wrong. The tests always come in some form or fashion because God wants to keep us close to Him. He wants to keep us trusting Him, learning this thing called faith. But when the test came, Peter failed the test big time. You ever failed the God test in your life?
Yeah.
He denied his Savior how many times?
Three times.
Pride comes before the fall, and the proper verse that goes with that saying is Proverbs 16:18. Do you remember this? Listen carefully to the scripture. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, notice he calls him Simon. Behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. That doesn't sound fun at all, does it? What about us? Have you ever, do you think just for a minute that Satan makes requests to sift you or me? Verse 32 of this passage I'll share in a moment. But I have prayed, Jesus said for you. I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, in other words, you're going to stumble. And when you come back, when you return, strengthen thy brethren. And this is, of course, before the resurrection. Then Peter said, and he said unto him, Lord, I am ready to go with thee and both into prison and to death. Notice the confidence, maybe the cockiness, pride. And he said, verse 34, I tell thee, Peter, notice the name change. Now Jesus addresses him as Peter, maybe because of his pride. The cock shall not crow this day, for that thou shalt thrice deny that thou knowest me. Luke 22:31-34. So now let's fast forward. Jesus is risen. Peter has denied him. We know how that ended. Three denials. Let's see what happened to Peter. Let's just read, I guess, one verse, and then we're going to follow this through for the next several weeks. Please stand, John 21:1. And folks, as much as I move around, let me move this before I wipe out half the stage. There we go. John 21:1. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. I see Matthew 28:7-10. And on this wise showed he himself. Praise God, he is risen. Please be seated. Follow along in your Bible if you would. Have your pen ready in case I add some scripture along the way. You want to follow, you want to study, you want to feel free to make sure what you're hearing from this pulpit, make sure what you're hearing is accurate, and we ask the Holy Spirit to help us. There were together Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus. What does that mean? He was likely a twin, the twin. And Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. It seems there were seven there. And Simon speaks up. Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. Say amen if that sounds like something you would say.
Amen.
I'm out of here. Where's the water? I go fishing. They say unto him, as most men would, we also go with thee. Fishing trip is on. Peter leading the way, they're going fishing. Remember, Jesus had called them to be, there it is, fishers of men, Matthew 4:17-19. He called them to be fishers of men. And of course, we know that we're to be fishers of men, that is, trying to lead souls to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ so they'll call out to Jesus and be saved. We're supposed to be doing this. So I preached this sermon years ago, can't remember when, but when I came to this part this time, I was more puzzled with what was Peter's motivation. I'm not saying I got it wrong, I just don't know. So here we go. It's hard to say. Were they going fishing, going back to the old way of life? In other words, forsaking their calling, or to provide meat for their families? I mean, you gotta eat, right? And if you need a pompano, you better take Mindy with you, right? Or were they going fishing for the fun of it? I thought I'd get an amen somewhere out of that. I mean, is it a sin to go fishing? I think not. I hope not. Because we've been sinning a lot lately, if that be the case. So I don't know what their motivation was, but what I do know, we do know Peter is leading the way. He's just a take charge guy. He's just a leader. But he's learning the process of doing it God's way and not Peter's way. They went forth and entered into a ship, immediately, and that night, dun dun dun, they caught nothing. Man, don't I know the feeling. Jack, I have set up shop on the side of a beach or a river in a boat. And I could put in 12 hours, maybe more. I could. Just staring at that thing, staring at a cork, staring at the tip of that thing. And of course, they were slinging nets all night, I'm sure. We got some mullet fishermen here, don't we? I know there's a couple of you that can sling a net. We live next to a man whose name is, I love southern fishermen. Y'all got it going on. His name is Petey. And we lived next to him for about 10 years, right, Mindy? And he was teaching me. I got me a little bait net to catch bait so I could use to hook a pinfish on and try and catch a redfish. I'd fish all night and catch every now. I mean, I'm not that terrible. Sometimes I catch them. But anyhow, Petey would take the nets. And you see these southerners, you'll see them out in the bay. I mean, they got the weight in their mouth, and they're slinging net over shoulders I don't even have. And there's net up here. I'm like, how are they going to do this? And all of a sudden, Petey and these folks I watch, they get that momentum going, and it goes out. Isn't it? It's a beautiful sight. Really. It goes out, and the outside weights catch like a blanket, and it just lands. And in a moment, just go to Now, Peter, fishing with a net, him and the boys are fishing off the boat all night long. I've become a surf fisherman more often than not the older I get. You know why? Because most of the work happens, I'll get to that in a minute, at the beginning and at the end. The rest of the time, I'm sitting in the sun in a lawn chair. Very little work involved, Steve. Surf fishing. In fact, here we go. I'll get up. We got up about, we set the alarm. Mindy and I planned a fishing trip where we had a babysitter. Amen. Then no more said. Up at 3, Miss Joyce. We're up at 3 a.m. The alarm went off, but she's like, let's go at 4. I said, amen. We'll go at 4. Snooze. So 4:15 rolls around. I had packed the night before. When you go surf fishing, you got to get your big old pole. Poles, I got several. You gotta get your sand spikes. Mindy bought me one of these trailers that I can drag all this junk through the sand. Now we go, you know, when I was used to be ate up with it, I'd go look for a good spot. Now we're looking for the closest road to the beach. Get all packed, get everything in a nice, wonderful avalanche. and it's perfect for this kind of thing. And we stop and we get our sand fleas. People up north do not know what a sand flea is. They freak out when they see a sand flea. We get our sand fleas and our live shrimp, and we get out there, we're all set. And it's a little bit of work at the beginning, a lot of work at the end. And there have been many times over the last 2 years, I do all that, get out there, and please, Jesus. I'm so bad, I'll say, Maddie, pray to Jesus. Try to get a child to do it. Peter had been out all night, nothing. Verse 4, but when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore. Did you see that? But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore. He's risen, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Probably just a passerby. Somebody's on the shore, Peter. It was actually the fisherman. Jesus is closer than many may think. Even when things aren't going good, even when you're not bringing in a mess of fish, even when things aren't going well with your family, even when things aren't going well at work, even when the bills are high and the income's low, did I say that right? Even when the doctor gives a bad report, and you don't really know if he's there, he's there.
Amen.
He's there. He's got you. Psalm 34, 18. Now let's think back before I read this. Peter had to be blown away because Jesus is alive, but Peter has also got to be wrestling and struggling internally, emotionally, just struggling with the fact that he had denied his Savior. Right?
Amen.
So Psalm 34, 18, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. Peter was broken. His heart was broken. Verse 5, then Jesus saith unto them, Children! I think that's an interesting way to call out to them, considering the fact that maybe he did, but not as often as other names that he gave them. But children seems to be the name he's giving them now that he's risen. The Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost are one. Amen. Born again believers are children of. Interesting. Then Jesus saith unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. Thanks for reminding us. Go ahead. I don't know how many times those Yankees that are down here as tourists walk by me. Did you catch anything? No. Keep walking. Ain't you got some restaurant to go to or something? Of course, the guy that walked by and asked yesterday, I had caught the shark earlier in the morning. I was able to tell him I caught a shark. Oh, but you're fishing for pompano, right? Yes. He didn't come back, and then he caught it. At least we could have showed him then. It's even been so bad with me. I've been down here a long time, and I'll come back to the truck after a long day of nothing, and no one gets checked on the beach by the authorities for if they've caught any fish. Some guy comes out of nowhere, was it last year, comes out of nowhere. Can I look in your cooler? Have at it. I think that's just one time a year that he looked in a cooler. He happened to look in mine. It's pitiful. All right, focus, Jeff.
I've seen you catch fish. It's not bad.
Gary's, yeah, but I gotta go with somebody that knows what they're doing. I go with Wayne Preston. I kill a deer. I go with Gary and I catch fish.
Hello.
Gotta go with people who know what they're doing. There's a sermon in that, isn't there? And Mindy, she got her hand up. We need a chair of shame to be descended. Verse 6, and he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. These are seasoned fishermen. These are guys like Gary, Hollis, these others, Jack, Harry. They know what they're doing, know what they're doing. And some stranger on the shore saying, do it again, but cast on the other side of the net. You got to wonder, pride's kicking in, like, who is this guy? Really? But this has happened before when they were first called. So I wonder if the light's starting to flicker. They didn't realize that God is guiding them. Even though Mindy caught the pompano. Even though Mindy caught the pompano. All that comes from the hand of God. And I think just to let us have some fun for this sermon and to let us finally eat some pompano. I bet that pompano started his journey about 4 a.m. from about 50 miles away just to find our hope straight from Jesus Christ.
Amen.
They didn't realize that God is guiding. Psalm 32:8. He will instruct us and teach us in the way we should go. He'll guide us with his eye, is what that teaches. Is God guiding you with every aspect of your life? We're talking about fishing today, but this could apply to any aspect of our lives. We need God to guide us in our jobs, or where to get a job, or what we're supposed to do in regards to our family, the church, everything. We need his guidance. Amen?
Amen.
And we blow it too often. Too often we try, without speaking the words or acknowledging God, we just go off and try to guide ourselves in nothing. Or worse than that. So they cast, therefore, and you know, really, you don't have to tell a fisherman. You always got to get that last cast in. The wife's saying, are you ever going to come home? One more cast, which turns into, so they were going to do one more. And Peter had seen this before, right? Luke 5:4-9, you can find it. Who is this man? Who is this man on the shore? Jesus knows where the fish are. Amen?
Amen.
He knows where they're at. He can provide, we can get our provisions from the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us. He shows us where to fish, not only for fish. He's teaching them here. He's teaching us here. Let's go spiritual. He knows where the souls are at that we're supposed to be fishing. Amen? And he knows when there's no fish in a fishing hole, and he knows, spiritually speaking, when you need to pull away from a situation where it's not time yet. Does that make sense?
Amen.
I was fishing for souls last week. I was out and about, let's just say, and I was witnessing to a young man who has had conflicts with me before, let's just say. But I'm not going to give up. I'm stubborn. I'll sit there for 12 hours and catch nothing if that's what it takes. But I'm sharing the gospel with him, and I'm getting this voice in my head, believing it is the Holy Spirit, saying, he's not ready. You're wasting your breath right now. Get in the van and drive away. And I did. Wasn't time. He brings the increase. 1 Corinthians 3:7. Jesus brings the increase. If the video's ready, I know we're a little past time, but you got to see this video. If you got time.
But sometimes you just hear it. You can't keep your head on a swivel. I mean, I look up and he's getting wet.
So God could show me how easy it is. So could Jesus have, you know, he had him throw the net on the other side. Could Jesus just have had the fish jump up on the shore? Being God, being the Lord of all. Notice Jesus wanted the disciples, don't miss this. He wanted the disciples to work for it. We can never give up on the soul. Never stop praying. He wanted them to work for it. He wanted them to serve him. They didn't even know it was him yet. And they're serving God. It's interesting to me that people will come here and they're not even saved yet, you know. And have you ever seen that around here? And they'll start serving because they just see other people doing it and they'll start serving. He wanted them to learn to be obedient, to act when hearing Jesus' voice, to be a part of the catching process. I mean, God could have just, these are saved, y'all don't do nothing, the rest of you aren't going to believe me, off you go to hell. Is that how it works? He wants us to, through the foolishness of preaching, through the sharing of the gospel, through making disciples, he wants you to be a part of the catching process. Amen. To bring him glory, amen?
Amen.
Even though they were tired, he still put them to work. Don't miss that, Emily First Baptist Church. Even though you're tired, don't grow weary in well doing. Go fishing and get a rest and then get back to work for Jesus.
Amen.
So with being fishers of men and fishers of women, we want to make sure that we work, that we serve, that we're obedient, that we act when we hear his voice, to be a part of the catching process. Even when things are tough and even when we're tired, don't give up. Verse 7, we're bringing this home. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved, who was that?
John.
The writer of this gospel saith unto Peter, it is the Lord. The light went on. That moment when you realize God's eyes are everywhere. Proverbs 15:3. So you might be asking the question, what will Peter do? You're going to have to come next week and find out. Please stand. Please bow your head if you are here this morning. And maybe you're going through something, help the Holy Spirit. If you're going through something you need prayer for, whatever that might be, the altar's about to open up and you can come and pray. We had some fun this morning. We're talking about fish and we're talking about this experience with Jesus and Peter and the disciples. But here's the reality. It's a very serious matter. That is your soul. Have you been saved? The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Our righteousness on our best day is as filthy rags. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Why do you say these verses over and over again each week, Pastor? Because this is a scriptural plan, God's plan, scriptural path, if you will, that shows us why we need to be saved because of sin, and it shows us the Savior. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart a man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Romans 10, 13 says that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. God wants to catch you, keep you, and bring you to heaven. He's the way. Jesus is the way. Having asked Jesus to be your Savior, you called out to him. Maybe you're here this morning, you've been saved, but you're going through stuff. He's nearby. He's never left you nor forsaken you. It may seem like he's in the distance, on the shore. But he's there. He's going to provide the need. He's going to meet the need. He's going to be there for you. He's not going to give up on you. He's going to finish the deal. What he started in your life, he will complete it. If you need prayer for any reason, you come. Jesus loves you desperately. He will never stop loving you. The altar is open. God, I need you.